Thank you for coming virtually to our another seminar session at the ATI. My name is Saida Davoodi. I'm an education and research program manager at ATI. I'm going to start with the land acknowledgement and then introducing our speakers for today. The University of Alberta acknowledges that we are located on Treaty 6 territory and respects the histories, languages, and culture of First Nations, Métis, Inuits, and all First People of Canada, whose presence continues to enrich our vibrant community. I also want to thank Paladin, our sponsors, for sponsoring our seminar series, and also a reminder for everybody that we will have research days on June 20 and 21st, and the link I believe should be in the chat box now, and if you register, you will be receiving a calendar invite.
So let's start with what virtual care is. So it's any interaction between patients or members of their circle of care that occurs remotely using any form of communication or information technology with the aim of facilitating or maximizing the quality and effectiveness of patient care. So with that definition in mind, we can confidently say that we've, in transplant services, been delivering virtual care for decades. Prior to phone calls being labeled virtual care. This is really what we've been doing historically in our program, and it's well established. So we started by collaborating with the Edmonton's own virtual hospital. And throughout the pandemic, we kind of were pushed towards exploring further opportunities within our own program to enhance the type of virtual care that we deliver to our patients. So, as you can see on the screen, the plan for today is to review the background of, you know, what enhanced virtual care means, why, the rationale for why we're talking about it today, our current state, the initiative itself that we're proposing and working on, our pilot project, and a little review of our next steps, because it's a big initiative, so we're taking it in increments. So we'll walk you through that today. So of course, a project this size, we have many stakeholders. So we want to acknowledge and thank all of them, because really, we wouldn't be where we are today without their support. We wouldn't have had a starting point and we wouldn't be making progress that we're making. So we do want to thank everybody that's been involved. So we're going to talk a little bit more about Edmonton Virtual Hospital in a moment, because they're an integral piece to this pilot project and to the overall initiative. They actually were the group that encouraged us to dig a little deeper within our own program, because we kind of originally engaged in a conversation with the Edmonton Virtual Hospital to talk about, is there a partnership here that we could develop and make accessible for our patients? So they kind of came into the conversation, started observing how we deliver care currently, and came back to us and said, you know what, there's definitely an opportunity here, but I think before we engage in that work, we really need to take a look at your internal processes and how we can enhance and leverage what's in existence already in the community and throughout the province. And the next, so that kind of led us to partner with Alberta Health Services Virtual Health Program. And they've been instrumental in this work. We reached out to them. They were very engaged and receptive to the initiative and actually partnered us with some project management team members who are actually helping us drive all of this work forward. And from those initial conversations, we kind of started building this partnership with Mobile Integrated Health Unit. And so this is a group of community paramedics that access and provide care to patients in their own homes. So our plans are to collaborate with this incredible group of health professionals to enhance the care that our transplant patients can receive in the comfort of their own home and community. So this care stream is going to be initiated. So when we're talking mobile integrated health partnership, this is going to have a provincial focus because they also have a north and a south program. So we've already engaged our Calgary transplant program in some of these initial conversations to move that work forward. And for those of you who are care practitioners within our transplant circle, the Mobile Integrated Health Unit is actually the team that has been delivering the Sotrovimab infusions throughout the province for our patients. So we already had established a really good partnership with this team, and now we're just looking to kind of leverage it. And then finally, we need to thank our transplant physician champions, our transplant nurse coordinators, and our administrative team for being very invested in this project. Because without our incredible team, we certainly wouldn't be able to deliver this type of care. So thanks, guys, for believing in the initiative. So I kind of chatted a little bit about the Edmonton Zone Virtual Hospital. So they are one of our stakeholders, and they've been providing enhanced virtual care in the community since 2018. So acute care has been shifted from traditional acute care delivery in a hospital setting to hospital level care in the community. So this type of care has shown to be safe, effective, cost effective for both patients and healthcare providers. So the Edmonton Zone Virtual Hospital delivers care in a couple of different ways. So they utilize digital remote monitoring, which we're going to talk a lot about today. And again, collaborating with those community partners like the mobile integrated health units, home care, and so on. So I kind of talked to you about the fact that we engaged originally with this group, so probably in about 2020, and then of course the conversation evolved, and here we are. So there's a ton of research and literature that's retrospective around the role that virtual care has played throughout the pandemic. A study by Wang et al. In 2021 confirmed for us that virtual care was adopted in Canada and globally as a means to provide safe, timely, and accessible ambulatory care. And as we know, virtual care has the potential to remove barriers to healthcare around, you know, availability, accessibility, and affordability. And Crystal's going to kind of talk a little bit more around the why. So the accessibility part was a part of our rationale for moving forward with this project, but she's also going to talk to you about length of stay, reduction in readmission, reduction in emergency visits, and overall just improved level of quality of patient care that we're delivering to our patients. So with that, I'm going to turn it over to Crystal to take us through the next set of slides.
I just want to have an introduction for Crystal. So Crystal is also a clinical nurse educator for recipient transplant services at University of Alberta Hospital. Crystal graduated from the University of Alberta in 2002 with a Bachelor of Science in Nursing. And currently she's working on her Master of Nursing through Athabasca University. And as a registered nurse for 20 years, Crystal has worked in various care areas, including with the inpatient transplant program on unit 3G2 and with the ambulatory program as a post-liver transplant recipient coordinator. Crystal has been working also as a clinical nurse educator for the last few years and is thrilled to be back supporting the recipient transplant program as an educator. Over to you, Crystal.
Thank you very much. And thanks, Kara, for starting us off in this presentation. So again, as Kara mentioned, we started thinking more and more about how we can enhance the care that we provide to our patients currently. As Kara mentioned, we've been providing virtual care to our patients since the inception of basically our program in transplant services. That is the basis of the care that we provide. So again, when we take this equation that's on the screen here, we look at what we have and how we manage, that's how we came to the solution. So first of all, when we talk about complex patients, we know that our Edmonton Zone Transplant Services Program cares for solid organ transplant patients, islet transplant recipients for both adults and pediatrics. And even though our program is located in Edmonton, we care for patients out of the zone. So our care is far-reaching in Alberta and elsewhere. And then we know that transplant patients are challenging to manage. They come to us in end-stage organ failure. So they're very sick already. They receive a life-saving organ transplant or life-saving preserving islet cell transplant. And they still are complex when they're transplanted and they receive that gift of life. And also to maintain that transplant, they're on lifelong immunosuppression, which again, they take to prevent rejection, but it makes them higher risk for things like rejection and other complications as well. So we want to protect those patients. And due to multiple health complexities post-transplant, unfortunately, our population does tend to have, repeated emergency department visits, maybe a longer length of stay in hospital with post-transplant and with any readmissions. So with that kind of equation at hand, we believe that the solution really is to enhance the care that we're providing to, again, give these patients that we already know are complex medically and surgically, to give them enhanced care in the community and keep them safe where they are, where they would prefer to be. And when we talk about that, we also have to think about what our goals are. And Kara had kind of touched on this too. So we thought, okay, so we have this equation, we have these patients, we're providing virtual care already, we're going to enhance it. So why are we doing this? Why are we doing this enhanced initiative? Well, these are the goals that we want to meet, right? We want to try to move the care that we're providing for our patients out of acute care into the community. So the first goal would be like preventing emergency department visits. Again, hopefully we can move that care out of the community. We want to prevent those readmissions. And we know that sometimes we're not going to prevent all of this. So if patients do end up in hospital, they do end up readmission to acute care. Hopefully we can reduce that with some of our extra surveillance monitoring in the community. And as well, because our patients do tend to stay in hospital post-transplant quite a while, maybe we can reduce that length of stay because we have that enhanced surveillance and monitoring. And the one goal that's not on this screen right now, but I would argue it's probably the most important, and it's due to that accessibility piece. We're going to improve that patient-centered care that we're providing with our patients, right? We're going to move that care instead of acute care and provide it in the community where patients are safe and where they would prefer. And again, we took a look at the literature putting this presentation together, and there was an interesting survey done by Canada Health Infoway. They did that in the summer of 2021 with 12,000 Canadian citizens, and they asked these participants of the survey how they felt about virtual care. So it was interesting to see that when they asked patients with chronic disease conditions how many would be interested in digital remote patient monitoring, 47% said that they were interested. They asked another population with COVID-19 symptoms the same question, and over 40% of those were also interested, as opposed to 6% of the chronic disease and 5% of the COVID-19 actually even receiving this type of care. So there's a big discrepancy with what patients want and what they're getting provided to them. In addition, in the survey, which we thought was really interesting too, is that 90% of respondents who actually had a virtual visit were really satisfied with that care that they received. 81% who had a virtual visit avoided an in-person visit. So again, that care was a bit more accessible for them in the community. And 91% of respondents who had a virtual visit said it saved them time and money. That, my friends, is patient-centered care. So when we looked at the data, we had a data pull from ConnectCare. We have a great informatics team that we also work with that probably should be on that stakeholders list as well. They were able to pull data for our patients because we wanted to see, again, if we have these goals in mind, is it going to validate what we want to meet with this initiative? So if we look at the data pull was from January 2020 to December 2021, and we looked at all organ groups and all patients. The average number of readmissions for all transplant patients was 989. And once the patient was readmitted, the average length of stay was 6.8 days. So almost a week in acute care. Same thing, we looked at emergency department visits, and the average for all of the organ groups for all the transplant patients was 328 visits. And after transplant surgery, the average length of stay between all of the organ groups was 30 days. So really, when we looked at this data, it just really highlights and validates why we're doing this project, why we're doing this initiative, and why we have the goals that we do. So we've come a long way, as Kara mentioned. We started with, you know, looking at Edmonton's own virtual hospital as our only kind of modality to enhance the virtual care we provide. And with their help, we've gone really far away from that. And we decided thinking about, okay, how can we enhance the care? Again, with that equation that I showed you internally, how can we enhance the care we already provide to our patients? So we've developed care streams and other type of processes. We actually have 10 digital remote patient monitoring systems in our ambulatory program right now, ready to go and ready to use. And we are continuing on with our collaboration with community partners, such as the Mobile Integrated Health Unit, which are those great community paramedics that we have experience working with already. And when we talk about care streams, this is kind of what we landed on so far. So the first care stream here, this is the internal process that we've kind of are looking at right now. And this is going to be for those issues with our transplant patients that are very transplant specific, where we really need management with a transplant coordinator, a transplant physician, and we're going to enhance the care that we're providing by using a digital remote monitoring system, maybe making a referral to the Mobile Integrated Health Unit, those community paramedics, to provide some community care for our patients, or maybe patients are going to require both. The second care stream, the Amazon Virtual Hospital Collaboration, that one is not, it's not put on the back burner right now, but it's not, hasn't gone away. We still hope to collaborate with them in the future. I must talk about that inclusion criteria too that I kind of skipped over here, but what we're thinking for all of our care streams, we're going to have the same goals that we have for all of our enhanced virtual care initiative, and the inclusion criteria is going to be quite broad, particularly for that internal enhanced virtual care stream. So what we're thinking right now is they're going to be, patient needs to be over 18 years of age, so followed by one of the adult programs. They need to reside in a catchment area, so somewhere likely in Alberta, where we have that reach with the digital remote monitoring and the Mobile Integrated Health Unit. And of course, they're going to have anticipated or unexpected post-surgical medical complications that can be managed in the community. So that's pretty broad. We recognize that. So we do know that they might need a little bit of tweaking once we get underway. But what we kind of thought was kind of interesting when we talk about inclusion criteria, again, looking at the literature, there was a study done by Thomas Jacques et al. From 2021 that did kind of hit home for us. He stated in his article that they recognize that depending on the enhanced care modality that we use, not all patients will be appropriate. So for utilizing the digital remote monitoring system, for example, patients will need a certain level of literacy and motivation to want to use the technology in a meaningful way. So I think when we're deciding on patients, we're going to take some of that literature that we've learned from our reading, from our review, and that's going to help us also decide on what patients we're going to utilize as well. So I'm also now going to hand it over to Dawn to finish off the presentation.
So I'm going to go ahead with introducing Dawn. So Dawn Campbell is also a clinical nurse educator for recipient transplant services at University of Alberta Hospital. Dawn graduated from the Saskatchewan Institute of Applied Sciences and Technology with a nursing diploma in 1993. She's working as a registered nurse and has experience ranging from adult long-term care and ICU to pediatric ICU at the Stollery, and also at the Texas Children's Hospital in Houston. Since 2009, Dawn has been working exclusively within transplant services at the U of A Hospital. She has worked in both donor and recipient coordinator roles and within the Living Donor Program. For the past 4 years, she has taken on a leadership role as clinical nurse educator for transplant services and enjoys engaging with the frontline staff to assist with challenging situation and to promote systems and processes as they continue to evolve. Over to you, Dawn, and thank you very much.
All right, so I get to talk about some of the more fun stuff. So how do we get this project moving? We keep talking about digital remote patient monitoring systems. Well, this is what it is. This is the kit that you're seeing. This is the same virtual equipment and platform that the Edmonton Zone Virtual Hospital uses. So what this kit includes is a tablet, a weight scale, O2 saturation and heart rate monitor, a blood pressure and thermometer. So the patient is able to easily access the tablet and get onto that Cloud DX platform where they're able to take their vital signs. They can also add in additional information like blood glucose measurements. They can manually enter those in. They can attend virtual appointments and assessments with their care team. And they can also receive different reminders that are set by their care team to help with keeping on track for medication schedule, or if they're due for blood work, those types of things that they can be having regular reminders for. One really important thing with this system is to know that all of these measurements that the patient is having done, or when they're entering that information into the Cloud DX, is that this is all real time. So that's really important, not just for the care team, but it's really important for the patient as well, because this is going to give the patient a little bit more confidence and independence for their care. They're going to be able to have an idea of how they're doing from a vital sign perspective. So some of those numbers that we look at as clinicians to gauge to how well our patients are, the patients have that feedback right away. Now, in turn, what happens for our transplant care team is that with this device, we are able to access the patient's measurements. We can set the different parameters for those vital signs. We can give that patient the reminders for taking their medications or for when their blood work is due. And then we can also schedule and attend those virtual appointments with the patient. Now, the system is great. It does all of this stuff for us. It collects that information from the patient, lets us see it. But Cloud DX will also alert our transplant care team when the patient is doing their vital signs. And if those measurements fall outside of the set parameters, the clinician is going to get an alert from the Cloud DX system. The Cloud DX system will also notify the patient if the patient is forgetting to get into the system and take those vital signs, or they're not meeting up with those scheduled appointments that have been set up by their care team. So the Cloud DX will stay on top of the patient as well. So Crystal and Kara have already talked a lot about what the benefits of using the digital remote patient monitoring. But the biggest thing is the accessibility. We are going to be able to access patients from not just local with providing that enhanced care, but we can also provide this enhanced care to those patients that are out in more of those remote rural areas. So that's really key here. This is also going to allow those transplant patients who may otherwise need to stay in acute care for different monitoring and surveillance, that maybe these patients can have the opportunity to be cared for at home where they're going to be more comfortable and hopefully be able to prevent any acute care readmissions, because we'll be able to take in those vital signs and some of those measurements and give us those red flags when things are starting to not look so good. Maybe we can intervene before those patients are getting too sick. And then the other idea that we are thinking with the benefit for this monitoring is that for those newly transplanted patients that are being discharged home and, you know, they have a few days or a weekend before they coming into their very first clinic visit, there can be a lot of anxieties and worry about what's happening. Maybe these patients can have the enhanced virtual care and be able to decrease the anxieties and have a better idea of where they are, where their health is at that point in time, and prevent some of those emergency visits for things that they normally, or that we could look after at home. Now, as Crystal had mentioned earlier, there are some challenges that do come across or that we have identified with the digital remote monitoring. There are going to be some of those patients that do have those health complexities that we can't manage in the community, that they will need to stay in the acute care environment. But having said all of that, that the biggest thing for us will be able to identify those patients that are getting sick. We get identify them early enough to help prevent them from those admissions. Or if they are admitted, we are going to hopefully be able to decrease their length of stay in hospital. Now, there are studies coming out, as Crystal has been mentioning. We've been doing a lot of reading and, you know, some validation and also just getting more information to how to best prepare for our initiative here. And we found a study by Gandhi et al. 2021 that indicated that the COVID-19 pandemic exposed the need to harness and leverage digital tools and technology for remote patient monitoring. Remote patient monitoring involves monitoring a patient's biometrics outside of a hospital or clinic setting with the associated transmission of data to clinicians in a manner that allows for actionable insights to improve health outcomes. So that's really important. And as we move forward, we'll show you how we can pull some of that information together to be able to have better insight and how do we act upon what we're seeing with the data that comes in. So as Crystal mentioned, the digital remote patient monitoring will be the initiated first in our initiative for enhanced virtual care. We already have some of our staff being trained to use the system. We're working on some of those supporting documents for our patients and clinicians that I will show you here right away. And really the big exciting point is we actually have 10 of these kits available ready to use, and we are really hoping to get started in August here this year. So the next thing, as I was saying, I'd show you is part of these supporting documents. One of them is this action plan. The action plans are tools that are to help guide decision making for the patient and for their clinician. So here is just a template. So this template was taken right from one of the action plans that the Edmonton's own virtual hospital uses. Since these guys are the experts in virtual care right now, we're going to just follow in their footsteps and adapt to a lot of the things that they do. So when we talk about action plans, we can think of these of being like a care plan, a plan that helps guide us for patients' care. How are we going to intervene with our patient and provide their care? So we are going to be using these action plans as the backbone for our enhanced virtual care that we're going to be providing. So as you see, there's three different zones. There's a green zone, yellow zone, and a red zone. Now, each of these zones are going to have patient-specific details in there that will contain different parameters that we're expecting for vital signs, how often they're going to be doing their vital signs. It's going to have other assessment points that the patient is going to be monitoring for themselves, so things like their incisions, surgical drains, how they're feeling, etc. The action plan is also going to include directions to guide the patient and the clinician on what action, if any, that needs to be taken. So if the patient is finding that a lot of the data that they're collecting or assessment information is falling into that yellow zone, well, the yellow zone means that they might have to increase the amount of the frequency of their vital signs, or maybe they know that, okay, well, this means that I need to call my coordinator and we're going to have a virtual visit just to kind of sort things out. So this action plan is going to help with giving that patient a little bit more independence on how to judge where their care is at and when they need to activate the healthcare system, which will usually start off with a phone call to the coordinator. These action plans, as I said, are going to be patient specific. So they're going to be completed in collaboration with the transplant physician and the care coordinator looking after that patient. And all of the details on here are going to mirror what the orders that are going to be placed for that transplant patient. So again, the studies do support various types of action plans. There's a study by Cassell et al. 2021 of remote patient monitoring done during the pandemic. There were 10 different hospitals in and around New York area where they utilized a strategy with calling it an escalation protocol. These patients were assessed for their oxygenation status. They were monitored with a machine, and then based on what their oxygen level was along with their symptoms, patients and health professionals were guided on what care the patient needed. Like, did they need further monitoring? Did the care need to be escalated to a physician? Or was the patient advised to go to the emergency department or call 911? So again, we're going to just kind of mimic what they're doing and adapt it to our patient population. So We've also talked about this mobile integrated health unit, so the MIH, and as Kara had mentioned before, that these are a group of specialized paramedics. And this program has actually been going, has been around since 2012. These paramedics have had some additional extra training that have combined with already their clinical experience in primary and urgent healthcare needs, kind of build this robust program, the MIH program. And like some of the tasks that this group can provide for us in the community is going out to do advanced cardiopulmonary assessments on patients. They can do peripheral IV starts and scheduled IV medication administration. They do central line care, drain and wound care. And they can also go and react to perform exasperation assessments and management of patients having trouble under the care or under the direction of the transplant physician or surgeon. Now, with this group, we're not starting with them right away. As Crystal had mentioned, we are just starting with that digital remote monitoring system, but hopefully towards into the fall, we will be having MIH come on board and we will have two options or three options for our patients in this care stream where they will either have just that digital remote monitoring or they can have just the medical or the mobile integrated health unit dispatched out to them, or we have a combination of both. So we have those three options in this care stream. So this is our pilot project. As we said, we're starting off small. We're hoping to start August 1st with that digital remote monitoring. And where we're at with being able to get going with this recruitment is we've got all of that education started with our coordinators for that Cloud DX system. We're working with having our super users for the system kind of brought up to speed with a little bit more education for troubleshooting with this system, and then continuing working or partnering with the AHS Virtual Health to help us moving forward a little bit more with our project as we are coming close to getting ready to start up here in August. We have a little bit more work to do with getting some of those supporting documents together, but we're coming to a point here, we are looking at bringing on 10 patients. We're going to start with just the liver and the kidney transplant programs. And the reason we chose these programs first is because they have the largest numbers of transplanted patients. So we thought it was a quick, easier win to get those numbers in and to start getting that data to start looking at evaluation. So we're looking at hopefully within the next 3 to 6 months, having at minimum 10, but hopefully building on more patients to collect more data. And as we are, once we get to that point of being able to evaluate our data, we want to see, like, is this initiative meeting those goals that we've been lining out to you throughout the presentation? And how do we evaluate that? So as we mentioned, that our Connect Care team has been fabulous with the amount of information they're able to pull for us. So they're working with us on, you know, how is the best way to pull the data? So how are we going to document to pull the data effectively? And we're going to look at questionnaires. So questionnaires that are already in existence. And then also looking at the provincial framework for evaluation tools as well. And we want to be able to not just evaluate on the clinician side, so what impact does this have on our workloads, or is this something that's feasible? Are we seeing improvements in our patient care? But we want to see on the receiving end of what we're doing on that patient side or the patient perspective. How do they feel with using this equipment? Is it as easy as we think it is? Is it something that they feel that their care is being enhanced and that they are helping meet their own care goals? Once we are able to evaluate all of this data, we want to be able to come together with our stakeholders and really suss out what worked, what didn't, what do we need to do to improve this? And if we are not meeting our goals, okay, well, are there things that we didn't think about or things that have come up during the project that we didn't even think about that we should be considering? And then we kind of go back to the drawing board and try again and hopefully bring on more organ groups in the future. And as we've already said, the next steps for getting to that point is we're going to continue with our working groups. We're going to continue working with the collaboration with Edmonton Zone Hospital, and we're going to continue working with MIH. We're going to be working on those supporting documents. We're going to be providing that education to our transplant care coordinators, and also with MIH or the community paramedics for more specific transplant education so they can start working with our patient population. And then, as we said, hopefully starting in August, and then as we start building more with our digital remote monitoring system, bring on MIH, and then really kind of pull everything together for our patient enhanced virtual care. And then these are a list of the references that we had used.
Thank you to all three of you for your presentations. I'm happy to moderate some questions. Please either use the chat box or put your hand up. I'll start with a few questions. Will there be an economic analysis of the cost savings with the service?
Yes, that will be part of our evaluation framework, most certainly.
And second question, any considerations using the PROMS or patient reported outcome measures in the evaluation?
Yeah, thanks, Patricia, for that question. We are actually in the midst of building the evaluation framework. So we have our own goals that we've kind of highlighted here, but we're partnering with, and Dr. Choi, you'll probably be able to comment a little bit on this development. The virtual health group is working very hard on an evaluation framework at a provincial level that we'll be utilizing as well. Obviously, there will be some differences because we'll have some transplant specific items that we'll be evaluating that may not necessarily be in the provincial evaluation framework, but certainly we will be working through all of that. Yeah.
Yeah, well, it's a very timely question because this morning we were just presenting to the Clinical Operations Executive Committee with Sid Viner and Deb Gordon, and basically asking for comments, approval, endorsement of the framework. I think that particular framework serves as a high-level document that the group will be creating, kind of like a playbook, if you will, for all programs wishing to evaluate, and primarily for assessing for future expansion. I do want to get to a question. Murray, who is a 7-year plus transplant, liver transplant recipient, would like to be involved in one of the first 10. How does Murray sign up for the program?
Well, so when we're doing our patient selection for the pilot project, we're working around clinically indicated need for digital remote monitoring, but perhaps Murray and I can connect offline because I wonder if he would like to be one of our patient advisors.
Yes, definitely. Most excellent, Murray, if you could kindly pop your contacts in the chat box or email Cara when we're done. For a question from Dr. Pearson, patients enrolled, what are signposts that indicate they are to be discharged from the RPM program?
That's a great question, Glenn. So I don't have an answer for that question quite yet. I think to start, certainly it's going to vary per patient. It's going to be based directly on their need. So I don't have a clear-cut answer to that because really we feel like the patient is going to kind of direct us. So what will happen is throughout the course of the digital remote monitoring, of course, there will be assessment and evaluation points of the patient with the transplant coordinator. And of course, the coordinator will work in collaboration with the physician. And that will be part of the conversation. Oh, I think we're in a really good place now. We can decrease the monitoring or we can stop digital remote monitoring because it's no longer clinically indicated. So I think it's going to vary significantly based on patient need.
Yeah, that is a very good question. Because again, this morning, one of the comments was, well, clinical appropriateness of virtual care or even hybrid care is now being talked about, where part of it's virtual, part of it's in person. So I think those are really good thoughts and good comments that our subject matter experts in conjunction. And this is a good segue to the next question, is how do we engage patients in developing the program so that the launch reflects patient needs?
Absolutely. And so that's where our patient reps will come in. So Murray, providing us feedback and being a spokesperson as someone who has been a liver transplant patient for several years. And the other piece we're working on is a focused patient survey that we'll conduct throughout the pilot. So it'll be that real-time feedback during that pilot as well from patients that are enrolled.
And the next question also ties into one that I have. Is this eventually for all patients or only patients identified as needing increased monitoring for a clinical change? And as a sort of a secondary part to the question, I wonder if there's been considerations. There's often discussion in terms of access and equity. And yep, we know, some of our rural zones don't even have proper internet service, and it might be hard to have these devices transmit the necessary data. So first question is it for all patients or only select ones? And second one is, what about the issue of equity and access?
Yeah, so that's a really good question about patient selection. So it is going to be for patients where it's clinically indicated that they require an enhanced type of monitoring, such as digital remote monitoring, or they require connection and work with the mobile integrated health unit based on their health needs. So I would say that no, it likely will not be everybody within the program, because as you know, we have thousands of patients, really and truly. It will be for those patients that it's clinically indicated. And we do plan on expanding to other organ groups. We are starting with liver and kidney, like Crystal and Don mentioned, but there is an intent that it will be available for all organ groups. And each organ group will have different reasons for utilizing digital remote monitoring and our mobile integrated health unit. So there's nuances between the programs, which will be why inclusion criteria for each program will look a little bit different.
So we have a great question from Linda along the same lines, which is, what about the patients that don't have access to virtual resources at home? Are these services able to be accessed through local care units? So in other words, is this service a continuous patient monitoring, or could it be done intermittently and they would just show up at a place that might have Wi-Fi or Bluetooth?
Yeah, so I'm assuming that the question is based around the internet accessibility piece. And certainly as we are fanning out, so as we move forward and we have a better understanding of what are some key barriers and key areas that have similar barriers, then we would work through that and look at partnership. I mean, there's telehealth capabilities. It could be something based on patient need that maybe they only need to do that digital remote monitoring the one time a day to do a set of vital signs, and we could partner with local health units. We're not there yet, but it's certainly not out of the realm of possibilities.
And I'm just going to comment to add to that, that the Cloud DX system does run on data. So we're not required to use the patient's own Wi-Fi to run that, to run the system, basically. So that's one nice thing that we liked about it as well. So we know that that could be an issue for some patients.
So there's a great question from Glenn about, do we have data on the length of stay, emergency visits, readmission rates by the organ groups? And then perhaps that might be interesting to look at which patients would require more DRPM and what specific monitoring tools. Is it video? Is it vitals?
Right. And so we do have that information per organ group. We kind of tossed around, should we present that? What would it look like on a slide? And it's a lot of information. So we chose to kind of just give a broad picture of length of stay and ED visits, but we certainly do have that information broken down by organ group. And you're 100% right, Glenn, that there's different levels of utilization and readmission rates and ED visits per organ group. So it would shift. The need will look different in each organ group.
And I think definitely, and I'll summarize the comment pertaining to clinical need and appropriateness, given the limited number of devices, and each of these kits, if I'm not mistaken, are between $500 to $700. Some of the components are reusable, but certainly we don't have enough kits for everybody that would need them, you know, and certainly transplant being only one patient population. I think perhaps a future work consideration of development of selection criteria past the pilot would be helpful.
Yes, absolutely. And then we've also discussed with SHI, so with the virtual health team, I know they're looking at different systems in the future. So we're waiting for some of that feedback. And should the pilot prove successful, and as we expand, we will go forward with funding proposals in our own program to support the purchase of our own in-house kits. Because right now, our 10 pilot kits are in kind, and we're very, very grateful for that, I have to say, but we do have intentions of walking through that process as well, because we do see the value in it.
Yeah, thanks for that comment, Kara, because Cloud DX right now is being used temporary basis, and then at some point, as the province moves forward to a provincial procurement, then the formal process to acquire this would be great. There's a question about will it, and I think that might refer to the hospital at home program. Will it include other services like IV meds, etc., beyond just simple monitoring of vitals?
Yeah, so the care streams will offer different interventions. So if we look at just digital remote monitoring in and of itself, the focus is on vital signs, virtual appointments, medication administration reminders, things like that. But when we look at the mobile integrated health unit, and Crystal and Don jump in here, they offer a variety of services, assessments, O2 titrations, IV infusions, IV starts, hydration, like a bunch of things. So we can look at different pathways depending on patient appropriateness and patient need.
And I would say probably the key thing that they can provide to our patients is that really good in-depth in-person assessment in the patient's home. So if that video visit is not good enough, it's not getting what we need, we can rely on those paramedics for that really good assessment and report back to the transplant team and the transplant physicians as well.
And perhaps a question for any of you is, when patients are set up, are they provided with some kind of training? And then, you know, if there are there safeguards in terms of potentially if people enter the wrong data, like they took their med, but actually they didn't, and how do you go in and correct that and that sort of thing? Is that type of training provided, and how long does it take?
So we understand, we're not sure of how long the process takes. I think each patient will be a bit different to how long comprehending the system, but Cloud DX does provide all of the training for the patient. So once they're registered, Cloud DX gets on line with the patient and they go step through step with the equipment. Any troubleshooting for the equipment usually will go through Cloud DX. We are going to be working with our team in-house here for being able to do some of the more simple type problem solving with the equipment. But aside from that, Cloud DX does have a large amount of hours, like 7 days a week till like 10, I believe, in the evening, support for patients to call. So I think for that example, you said if they've entered in some of their own information and they entered it in incorrectly or needing some correction with some of the documentation, it's just a matter of contacting the coordinator, talking it through, and then we would be ensuring our care records within Connect Care are accurate, and then working with the Cloud DX to making those corrections if the clinician wasn't able to make those corrections on our end.
Here's a good question, and I think it depends, but when patients need IV medications, are they considered inpatients in the virtual hospital, in which case are the costs of IV medications covered by AHS and Alberta Health, or do they have to pay for them out of pocket like the home IV program?
Mm-hmm. So it's definitely different than the home IV program. So when someone is admitted into the Edmonton Zone Virtual Hospital, that's what you're looking at. That is treated, I believe, like an inpatient admission in terms of costing. Yes. And I believe mobile integrated health unit functions in a similar fashion. Though that's something that, because we're in early stages, we haven't reached that level of discussion. I'm making an assumption, but I believe that that's how they function.
And, you know, I see a lot of great positive comments, maybe in the last, and just as a reminder, next week's presentation is in the documentation. But maybe 1 minute to each of you, Cara, Dawn, and Crystal, where do you see the future? Like, if this goes, what's it going to look like and how do we make it sustainable? So maybe starting with you first, Cara, and then we'll move to
our other two. That's the question that I'm going to need longer than a minute, because Don and Crystal have heard me talk a lot about this for our transplant patients. So very quickly, I see it fanned out across all organ groups. I see it moving into the pediatric population. I would love to see some partnership with our out-of-province partners so that it really does improve our accessibility. Talking just Alberta, I'd like to see the digital remote monitoring piece right back to Calgary. So at least at minimum, a provincial strategy for a digital remote monitoring, and we do have intentions. If you want to start talking like future wants, I would like to see us expand to our rehabilitation services and be able to offer our prehab to our patients in their home, our post-rehabilitative needs. You know, I really do think that the possibilities are endless. I mean, if you're really getting big, I'd like to see virtual hospital itself expand beyond the Edmonton zone borders. I think we could look, it would be great to see a provincial model. It would be great to see a transplant arm only developed. Like there's so much I could go on. I think there's a lot of potential, and I think we've always been a group that's been innovative and cutting edge. And you know, as we dig through this work, we're a well-established team in virtual care, and we can really take it as far as it can go, I think.
Well, thank you for that, and certainly no shortage of work moving forward. Dawn, how about you?
I kind of mimic exactly what Cara is saying. Like, this has been a great opportunity for transplant to be able to take this on at this stage of the game and kind of be a pioneer for really pushing forward or pushing the limit for virtual care for our patients. And as Crystal had mentioned before, you know, getting patients out of hospital sooner, getting these patients into their homes, being able to provide that enhanced care is what patient-centered care is all about. We're saving money, we're making safe, ethical decisions, and providing care for these patients.
And on to you, Crystal.
Yeah, and again, I'm just going to kind of echo what Dawn and Cara had said too. And I really think about too how like our clinicians are already providing this virtual care, and we do it well, we're experts in it, but just that enhanced information that we're going to get from that surveillance and monitoring with the Cloud DX system, I think will be mind-blowing. I think our patient empowerment will be mind-blowing as well. And so I think to me, that I know that's not as huge of a vision as Cara had shared, but I think in the interim, that first thing that we see, I think will be, again, that in patient empowerment and empowerment for our clinicians as well.
Well, thank you once again to all three of our panelists. And again, apologies for being late. Look forward to hearing more and working together to enhance virtual care in Alberta.
Absolutely. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you, everybody.
Thank you for having us.